Welcome to Unscripted, the AMCP podcast, a look inside managed care pharmacy. Listen in as experts explore the challenges, innovations, and opportunities shaping healthcare for millions of patients. This episode of Unscripted, the AMCP podcast, is sponsored by AbbVie, Inc. AbbVie, we find answers that make life better for patients and our world. September is National Alopecia Areata Awareness Month, and in this episode, we'll discuss alopecia areata, its impact on patients, treatment guidelines, and the emerging pipeline with Dr. Arash Mostaghimi. Dr. Mostaghimi is Associate Professor of Dermatology, Vice Chair of Clinical Trials Innovation, and Director of the Dermatology Inpatient Service, as well as Co-Director of the Complex Medical Dermatology Fellowship at Brigham and Women's Hospital. Welcome, Dr. Mostaghimi.
Thank you so much for having me.
It's really a pleasure to get you on. Why don't we begin? Could you provide us with a little background on alopecia areata?
Absolutely. Alopecia areata is an autoimmune disease of hair loss. So breaking down what it means, alopecia just means hair loss of any type, and areata means round. And one of the clinical features of this disease is that you lose hair in round patches. The most common place to lose hair is on your scalp, but you can lose it anywhere on your body. Most people just have one or two patches, but in some people, it goes on to involve their entire scalp or their entire body. The entire scalp is known as alopecia totalis, and the entire body is known as alopecia universalis. It can occur at any age, but it typically has two peaks. One is in childhood, and one is really in the 50s and 60s, but anybody can get it at any age. And the most important part, as I mentioned before, is that it's an inflammatory disorder. We can't see the inflammation. The skin looks the normal color because the inflammation is at the base of the hair follicle. So you get inflammation, it weakens the hair falls out, and there's persistent inflammation, which in some patients keeps the hair from coming.
So I think that's a really important point you raised. Most people look at this, they think it's cosmetic, you know, something like that, but it really is based on underlying inflammation for the individuals. So when you think about the condition itself, how do you classify severity?
So for alopecia areata, there's many challenges in classifying the severity. It is a disease that has very few physical symptoms. Maybe about 10 to 15% of people may describe burning or itching at the sites of hair loss. And if you lose your eyebrows or eyelashes, you may get sweat or dust or other things in your nose and your eyes that can bother you. But unlike, let's say, atopic dermatitis, where you're itchy all day, having difficulty sleeping, things along those lines, this has minimal physical symptoms. Where it really impacts patients is psychosocially. So if you think about the impact of hair, hair is really important for how we display ourselves and portray ourselves to others. So for those of you who are watching this online and seeing the video, you look at me, I'm wearing this suit, I'm wearing a bow tie. This is how I prepare myself and how I present myself in professional settings, right? If you saw me on the weekend or at my house, I'd be dressed very differently. I'm projecting a different image. But imagine if I looked exactly the same, I was dressed the same, but I had a mohawk instead of my current hairstyle. Imagine if I looked exactly the same, but when you look closely, like something's off, and you look that, like it looks like I shaved off one eyebrow. Both of those things would give you a completely different impression about myself. If my hair was pink, it would give you a different impression of who I am. It would be me using my hair to express myself in a different way. And for patients with alopecia areata, really any type of alopecia, but particularly alopecia areata, they lose that ability to express themselves. They may lose some aspects of their personality, some aspects of their appearance. They may lose their sense of sexuality or gender orientation. It can become really challenging. And the impact of that loss is felt on social relationships, is felt in the workplace, is expressed itself in terms of anxiety, sometimes depression, and other broad impacts on one's life.
So given that this condition, as you're thinking about it and dealing with it, you really need to think about it much more broadly and look at areas like quality of life, where they are from a mental health perspective, et cetera, and bring that information in as you're working through it.
That's right. So getting to your question on severity, the historical way the severity has been measured is simply as a function of scalp hair loss. So we identified that to qualify for the trials, you had to have over 50% scalp hair loss. That's what was considered severe. I find that to be a frustrating and somewhat arbitrary number. If I lost 45% of my hair, I wouldn't say that's not severe, then 5% more, all of a sudden I have a problem. Imagine losing half the hair on your scalp. That's really a considerable impact on your appearance and look. What we've evolved, though, in our definitions is away from using scalp hair loss solely as a determinant, but using it as a foundation of a new model called the ASC, or Alopecia Areata Severity Score, which what it does is it begins with the amount of hair loss, with 51 to 100% being severe, 21 to 50% being moderate, rather, and below 20% being mild. But it allows you to consider those other aspects of the person, the way you just mentioned. So if you have significant and rapid hair loss, if you've been refractory to treatments, if you have psychosocial impact, or if you have facial hair involvement, loss of eyebrows, eyelashes, beard hair, that gives you an additional boost. So somebody, for example, with 25% hair loss, but who didn't want to go to school anymore or had, refuses to leave the house, that's a person that, although their hair loss may be technically in the mild category, the overall condition would be rated as severe.
Yeah, it's fantastic to see you bring in those other life measures, because they really are critical for the patient themselves and how they're able to interact with the world. So where are we in terms of advocacy and the individuals who are working with them, perhaps family members, spouses, friends, et cetera? How should they be looking at this?
So it's important to appreciate that alopecia areata doesn't just impact the person with the disease. Well, first, let me take even a step back. Alopecia areata impacts everybody differently. There are patients who lose all their hair, are not impacted by it, they're happy, they have completely full lives, and it's important that we don't pathologize their experience or stigmatize them in any way. On the flip side, there are patients who have minimal amounts of hair loss that deeply affects them. I have a patient who had maybe less than 5% hair loss, which by the scale we just talked about would not be considered severe at all, but really wanted a specific hairstyle for her wedding that matched the same hairstyle that her mother had had in her wedding. If she styles her hair in that manner, it would reveal these areas of hair loss. And she delayed her wedding by 2 years, waiting for the hair to come back. That's somebody who I would say is profoundly impacted by this disease, even though the actual percentage of the amount of hair loss may be low. And you can imagine that was her alopecia areata, but it clearly impacted the groom. It clearly impacted the rest of the family as well. And I can speak to this on a personal level as a parent of a daughter with alopecia areata. My daughter lost all of her hair at age 5, shortly before she began a kindergarten. And it really led to a lot of stress for her, although she probably did the best of it of anybody in her family, really mainly for me and my wife. My daughter was coming into her own socially. She has a very outgoing, bubbly personality. She was excited about, for the first time, going to school, as kindergartners are. And we were worried about bullying. We were worried about her developing in the way that we wanted her to, and her ability to make new friends, and her ability to really appreciate school, enjoy her school, and develop in the way that we wanted. And I'm by nature an optimist, and I know a lot about this disease, of course. This is what I study and what I do. And despite having an optimistic nature, I found, without it being in my control, me worrying about things that had never happened and may never happen. What would middle school look like? How about the high school prom? What would her wedding look like? These are things I had never considered, but the potential of those future challenges for your child, and all of us with children know the last thing you want your children's life to be as easy and fulfilled as possible. It really had a lot of impact on me. It had a lot of impact on my wife, and it must have had impact on my younger daughter as well, who wasn't affected by that. So this is a disease that, while it starts with an individual, whenever you have significant psychosocial impact, that is not—it's not like having a sore arm that only hurts you. It really impacts the way you interact and your relationships with those around you.
And given that, and the variation in how it impacts individuals, where are we with treatments?
So we really are in a golden age of alopecia areata treatments. Although I would say to mix metaphors, we're in the early innings as well, right? So we went 5 years ago. If you had alopecia areata, we didn't have any FDA-approved treatments, and now we have 3 FDA-approved medications. One important thing to note is that for most diseases, you start with treatments for mild and moderate disease. There's some patients that are difficult to treat, and eventually you get more medications for them. For alopecia areata, the only FDA-approved medications are for severe disease. And we have limited treatments for mild and moderate disease, and hopefully we'll have more options for those patients over time. For severe disease, the three medications are all JAK inhibitors. You have the first one approved was baricitinib or Olumiant. That's a once daily JAK1, 2 inhibitor that comes in two doses, 2 milligrams and 4 milligrams. That was introduced about 3 years ago. The second medication was ritlecitinib or Litfulo. This is a once daily 50 milligram JAK3 TEC inhibitor. The real advantage of Litfulo is that it is the only medication we have that's currently approved for adolescents. So those 12 and up can take the medication. Although I mentioned that alopecia areata impacts a lot of children and people at any age, we don't have any FDA-approved medications for people under the age of 12. And the newest entry to this is Leqselvi or deruxolitinib. And deruxolitinib is a twice-daily 8-milligram JAK1-2 inhibitor that was just recently released. So these are oral systemic medications. Because they're JAK inhibitors, they all have the same black box warning as the JAK inhibitors, everything in that class does. And while they're effective for many patients and it's so exciting to have them, of course, not all patients will qualify for them based on what other diseases or comorbidities they may have. And of course, not every medication works in every person, but it's wonderful to have new options.
Yeah, it was really fantastic to see these coming along. As you said, the advancements just start progressing more and more rapidly. So given that, we have current guidelines. Where are we with those and what might be coming out in the future?
So I'm excited to report I'm chairing the joint guidelines coming from the National Alopecia Areata Foundation and American Hair Research Society. These guidelines are in their final form of development. They're the only guidelines we have in the United States and will be out publicly by the end of this year or the very beginning of next. So I look forward to reviewing those in detail. I'm inviting myself back to your podcast so I can review those in detail when the time comes. And what those really do is they consolidate the information about the new approved therapeutics with a focus on patients with severe disease and contextualize what we have in the new FDA-approved treatments relative to older non-FDA therapeutics, which were what we use historically.
And I believe there are some issues with when individuals get treatment and how long they've possibly been suffering from this. Could you go into some of that?
That's right. You know, one unique aspect of this disease is in contrast with other inflammatory disorders, the earlier you treat, the better you do. So, for example, if you have a patient with psoriasis and the patient is on the fence about starting a therapeutic, it doesn't really matter if, you know, they come back 6 months, 1 year, 2 years later. Once you start a biologic therapy, it's going to work the same at that point as it would have had you started it today. For alopecia areata, we're identifying that that's not the case. There's really two main drivers that predict response to therapeutics for alopecia areata. One is the severity. How much hair loss do you have? The more hair loss you have, the harder it is to treat and the harder it is to get you back to looking and feeling like yourself. But the second most important thing is the duration of the current illness. And I want to be clear about what this means. So this doesn't mean like I got alopecia at age 4 and now I'm 20 years old and my duration of illness is in 16 years. It's not about the initiation of the time you had the disease. It's about the time in which you entered the current state of hair loss. So for example, if you've lost all your hair, when you entered that current duration of illness, the moment you had finally lost all your hair. And we identify that that current duration being over or below 4 years is the key. That after 4 years, the response in terms of how much hair is regrown and the speed of that response is less than people who have had the disease for a lesser duration. It's important to note that even if you've had the disease for a long time, maybe I've had some patients who are 30 years old who lost all their hair at age 3, it's completely possible for them to grow back their hair and even grow back all of it. The likelihood of response is lower and the speed of response is lower. So it's important to keep that context in mind. So for a lot of patients, particularly those who are ambivalent, earlier initiation of treatment, more aggressive therapy earlier in the process may give them additional optionality later. And better outcomes if they start sooner.
So given that, along with the psychosocial issues, mental health, things like that, and how should managed care plans look at this?
The most important thing for managed care plans to understand is that, as we started off, this is not a cosmetic disease. This is not a cosmetic disease. Is about making people a better version of what they were before. I would argue that a breast augmentation might be cosmetic. A reconstruction after a breast cancer surgery, right, a mastectomy, in my opinion, would not be cosmetic. It would be restoring function and view. And in the same way that we've accepted those types of therapies as appropriate medical treatments, alopecia areata should be considered in the same light. And as I said before, patients don't have to get treatment if they don't want it. But for patients who are profoundly psychosocially impacted, I have patients who have dropped out of college that mentioned the woman who delayed her wedding. The people who have really become recluses have developed agoraphobia and entered their home. And it's amazing that when these patients begin to grow hair and begin having that confidence again, it's like resetting your computer when it doesn't work at all. They come back to life and everything is fulfilled and they're back to new. And we, as I say, we cry two times in my clinic. Once is when you first come and the hair has fallen, and the second time when you come back and you feel like yourself and you're looking and feeling the way that you want. It really is a remarkable gift to give to people. And in treating that, it's not only about the alopecia areata. There are comorbidities that about 25 to 40% of patients with alopecia areata have, not just the psychosocial comorbidities of anxiety and depression and agoraphobia and all those types of things that I mentioned before, but atopic dermatitis, vitiligo, a higher risk of thyroiditis, things along those lines. And although we don't have complete data, there's some suggestion that earlier treatment of alopecia areata certainly will modify the risk of the psychosocial impact and may also impact other comorbidities as well. So when you're treating these patients, not only are you helping them look and feel the way that they want and restoring substantial function to them, you're reducing hospitalizations for psychiatric care, you're reducing inpatient care for other reasons. You know, you're reducing suicidality, suicide attempt, and even sadly completed suicide rates is the thing we're ultimately trying to avoid. So this is not just a hair disease. This is a disease of self-expression that impacts patients completely. And it's wonderful that we have these treatments. And when you look at diseases that we currently cover, moderate to severe psoriasis, moderate to severe atopic dermatitis, although alopecia areata does not have the physical impact of those diseases in the same way, the psychosocial impact puts this clearly at the same level as patients that will qualify for systemic therapies with both psoriasis and eczema. We should treat this the same way.
So you've sort of touched on how payers should consider this disease. What about patients and clinicians? And if you have anything else to add for the payer side of it, please go ahead.
Of course. So for patients, it's an exciting time. It's really important that we get the message to patients that we now have opportunities. A lot of these patients have come to their dermatologist for years, have been turned away, told that there's nothing more we can do. There's no treatment that will work. We now have choices and options, and you should reach out to a dermatologist, have these conversations, see if you qualify for the medication, and determine whether it's the right fit for you. As I said before, this may work for anybody. But particularly if you're on the fence and you are on the earlier side in your alopecia journey, you may identify that these drugs work more efficaciously and faster. And if you have an opportunity to take advantage of that, you should. For physicians, it's time to turn the page on the old therapeutics. We used to use a lot of off-label use, methotrexate, azathioprine, cyclosporin, injectable medications for long periods of time, pulse steroids for long periods of time. The JAK inhibitors have their own risks and benefits, and you have to have shared decision-making with patients to have those conversations and monitor them appropriately. But what you have there is not just a risk, but a true benefit. With these older medications, you have exposure to potentially toxic medications with minimal risk. And you'll see in our guidelines when they're available that starting and being aggressive about starting JAK therapy for patients with moderate to severe alopecia areata is a place you should start, and the earlier you get there, the better your patients will do. And of course, we can't get those medications unless payers work with us in order to give our patients access to these medications, which in some situations can be life-saving.
Yeah, I really want to thank you for that information. I think the points you raised about looking at this much more broadly, particularly from the payer side, are critical to understand the impacts on individuals and their quality of life. So thanks again for joining us, Dr. Mostaghimi.
Thanks for having me. I really appreciate the conversation.
And thank you for listening to this episode of Unscripted, the AMCP podcast. This episode was sponsored by AbbVie, Inc. For more information, go to abbvie.com.